we present the first in a series of six conversations between Eric Hoffer and James Day.
Eric Hoffer is a laborer. For more than 40 years, he has supported himself by the strength of his hands and back. As a longshoreman on the San Francisco waterfront, as an agricultural worker, and as a miner. He is also a writer. His three books and several essays have won him the highest praise of literary critics. They are the product of a self-educated man. He never finished grammar school. Born in the Bronx, the son of a German cabinet maker, Eric Hoffer was to lose his mother and his sight at the age of 7, and his father when he was 18. The 8 years of his blindness, he recovered his sight at 15, left him with an enormous appetite for the printed word, an appetite that has not diminished in the years since he moved to the West Coast to become a migrant laborer, a miner, and a dock worker. In 1951, he published his first book, The True Believer, a study of the nature of mass movements. 3 years later, he was to publish 280 aphorisms under the title The Passionate State of Mind. His most recent book, The Ordeal of Change, is a collection of essays that deal with a crisis of self-esteem each of us suffers when faced with the new and the unknown. Mr. Hoffer, in the opening sentence to your book, The Ordeal of Change, you say that we're all afraid of the new. Why is this?
Well, you know, as an American, I shouldn't have been interested at all in the question of change. After all, we are awfully familiar with change. We change our places, we change our jobs, we change husbands and wives, we change even friends, just like that, see? To us, change is no problem at all. Now, you know, right after the war, something has happened everywhere, you know, in Asia, in Africa, in Latin America. There was, we were told there was an awakening. That backward countries, underdeveloped countries, began to modernize themselves in a hurry, to industrialize themselves. And I ask myself the naive question, what happens when an underdeveloped country, a backward country, wants to modernize itself? All it has to do is a few practical, sober things. It has to build a few roads, a few factories, some hospitals, some schools. Now, these are all practical things there. Now, why do they have to stage a madhouse in order to accomplish such sober, practical things? Now, in this country, if you want to build a factory or you want to build a town, all you have to do is take the phone, call up a contractor. The contractor will do all those things without hardly changing the rhythm of life around him. And I just groped, turned things in my mind for a long time to find out what it is. And finally, I settled on that almost implausible thing, see, that the real problem is the problem of change. You take a population, you subject it to drastic change. That means that you turn that population into a population of misfits. Now, misfits live and breathe in an atmosphere of passion. A misfit needs self-confidence. He needs self-respect. If he gets a chance to acquire those things by action, by proving himself, fine. But if he doesn't get a chance, an easy way, and a relatively easy way to gain self-confidence and self-respect, then there is the devil to pay. He needs substitutes for self-respect. He needs substitute for self-confidence. And once you go in for substitutes, you are in an atmosphere of passion. You have to stage a madhouse. For the substitute for self-confidence is faith. Faith in what? Faith in a leader. Faith in a nation. Faith in the holy cause. And before you are through with that, before you acquire faith, and the substitute for self-respect is pride, before you acquire those things, you have a heated atmosphere, you have a bedlam atmosphere, you have to stage a madhouse. And this was my first approach. I actually, in this book, Mr. Day, if you'll notice it, in each chapter, more or less, I try to approach the problem from a different angle there, see. I'm groping around. And the more I turned that problem in my mind, the more complex it became. I could see that I've suddenly realized the change is actually against human nature. Now, we Americans are used to change, but we are a novelty. We are an unprecedented population. No population ever before has adjusted itself to change the way we have adjusted ourselves. And this has happened only in the last 100 or 150 years. See? We are, in this sense, a new species. That is adjusted to a world of perpetual technological change. And for all I know, maybe what's going on in Russia now is to develop a new human mutation, see, a new type of man that will be adjusted to change. They do it in a different way. They just dehumanize people. They turn them into material, into plastic thing that you can, you turn people into flexible objects that'll be ready to love what they hate what they love, not know the difference between truth and lies. In other words, this is also a way of creating a population that's highly adjusted to change.
Why do you refer to a nation in change as a nation of misfits? Why must change bring about misfits?
Why, this is self-obvious, Mr. Day, that if you take, for instance, a nation that has been living for thousands of years in a certain mode of life, and suddenly you change the mode of life completely, then they are misfits, see? They have to adjust themselves to a new mode of existence. Actually, as I told you, Mr. Day, I think change is against human nature. In all the millennia of man's development on this planet there, change was a very rare occurrence and a very brief occurrence. See, you go, and even in this country, open a book. I just recently reread Henry Adams' History of the United States during the first Jefferson administration. Now, the first sentence, the first page there, shows you that the people in America at that time lived the way it was 1800, lived the way people lived in the 8th century, maybe lived the way people lived 3000 BC, or even prehistoric times there, see. Now, as you look all over the world right now, to me, I seem to see people leaping all over, in Africa, in Asia, in Latin America. They're trying to leap from the Stone Age into the 20th century. Now, that leaping business is a terrible thing. You can break your neck doing it, see? And in that first chapter there on drastic change, I tried to develop the idea that, unlike what we thought before, for instance, the true believer, I elaborate the idea that a revolution is an instrument of change. Actually, revolution is a byproduct of change. It's a result of the irritations, the difficulties, the pain that's generated in a population by the process of change. And then comes the revolution.
I mean, the change must come first before the
revolution. Absolutely. The last sentence in that chapter says, where things haven't changed at all, there's never a revolution. Change starts first. And then you see change, I say revolution is a byproduct of change. Just a juvenile delinquency is a byproduct of the passage from childhood to manhood. Or like indigestion is a byproduct of digestion. That's all there is to it. Yeah. Because revolution is an explosive thing. And change is an explosive process. Now,
are there conditions under which change can take place without creating, as
yes,
you phrase it, a madhouse?
Yes, yes. Now, for instance, you take Puerto Rico right now. There, they also industrialize themselves in a hurry, but it's done in a sober atmosphere. And why? Well, because they are supplied with skills, they are supplied with capital, with means there, and the people there have a chance to acquire self-confidence and self-respect without the substitute. To me, in the chemistry of the soul, a substitute is a very explosive thing. You know, if you can't have the real thing is, for instance, self-confidence is always a moderate sober thing. I mean, you are not absolutely confident in yourself, but you get along if you have certain confidence in yourself. And the same with self-respect. But if you have to have faith in something, it has to be absolute, because you have to cling to something that's outside yourself. You know, it has to serve as a substitute for first choice, see? And you have to convince yourself that this is not so much a substitute as the real thing, see? After all, faith in a leader is not really a substitute for self-confidence, you know? It's not. You have to convince yourself that this is it, see? And this conviction needs self-delusion. It needs a madhouse again.
And you've said that pride is also a substitute, so that this would also...
Yeah, it's be, also explosive. In the extreme. Wherever you come across a passionate pursuit, see, you can almost say automatically that this man is pursuing a substitute. He's pursuing something that will serve as a substitute for something lost or something unattainable. See, all the passionate pursuits are practically always pursuits for substitutes. See, if you can see. People, all novels tell the story about a man who has lost in love. You know, I mean, he was in love and he was disappointed. And then suddenly he becomes an industrialist, becomes a scientist, something like that. And he's going like blazes there. See, this is, again, he's looking for a substitute for something lost, whether it's paradise lost or love lost or respect lost.
Well, why must these nations you're speaking of that are so potentially explosive, why must they seek substitutes? Why can't they seek self-respect?
How do you get self-respect, Mr. Day? See, how? You take, for instance, a misfit there. Now, the easiest way to self-confidence, for instance, is action. See, I look for what happened in this country. You transferred, during the last 100 years, you transferred millions of peasants from Europe to this country and change their lives almost overnight. See, not only a new country, but a new way of life. They came from sleepy little villages, from warm communal life, and suddenly they were dumped here on this continent, strangers, and in a cold world. And yet, you didn't have no revolution here. You didn't have no mass movements here. Why? Because they had tremendous opportunities for self-assertion, tremendous opportunities for proving their worth, tremendous opportunities for acquiring self-confidence and self-respect, see. Now, you'll see that in most of the countries now, most of the underdeveloped countries that are modernizing themselves in a hurry, see, there are very meager chances for the individual to do something on his own so that he can prove his worth and acquire this individual respect and individual confidence. There they have to get it in with substitutes. But the question of change goes even much deeper. I told you, Mr. Day, that change goes against human nature. You know, you can, you know, when you change all of a sudden, a drastic change from one mode of life to another, you actually can't take it. You have to convince yourself, you know, that you are now something altogether different from what you were yesterday, see? You have to acquire the illusion that you are reborn anew, that you have a new life now, see? And you'll see in every case where a drastic change is taking place there, see? There is that staging of a play. There is a staging of the illusion, you know, that something new is born, that something unprecedented is taking place there, see? And as I said, I started out with these underdeveloped countries, see? And only towards the end did I realize, see, that what is now happening in the underdeveloped countries has actually happened to the Occident too. That we too had a madhouse. We too had explosions all over the place. Now you take, for instance, the growth of nationalism, of socialism, of communism during modern times, you know, during the last 100 years or so, was also a byproduct, you know, of the drastic change of transforming millions of peasants into mechanics, into industrial workers there, see. Of course, some of these peasants acquired a new identity by crossing the ocean and becoming Americans. Mm-hmm. See. This This was indeed a new life, because in order for drastic change to proceed more or less smoothly, see, you need the people who are experiencing that drastic change must have a chance to acquire a new identity, must have a chance to feel that they are new people, that they are living a new life. Now, the peasant who came over to this country actually was reborn. It was a rebirth. He had to learn a new language. He had to eat different food, was dressed differently, changed even his name. See? And now we can see something similar happening in Israel there. See? Here, over there, you have something different. You have to take shopkeepers and intellectuals and turn them into soldiers and farmers. And there again, there's a new life coming out. They are reborn to new life. They have to learn a new language. And everybody you've noticed takes a new name, changes his name there. It's a new identity. Of course, in Europe, too, there was the acquisition of a new identity. In Germany, for instance, where the change was most rapid, because Germany had to catch up, see. Germany was a late arrival. See? You had this sudden feeling that you are a member of the new Reich, that you are a member of a nation of warriors. You see, wherever there is drastic change, you have these masquerades, you have these acting, these plays, you assume the role of a saint, of a warrior, of a pioneer, see? And this is what's bothering me now, you know, Mr. Day, about the terrific change that the Negro is aspiring for right now.
Yes.
See? Suppose the Negro gets all he asks for. Suppose he gets equality. Suppose he gets desegregation. Still, the problem will be there.
Why?
Because that, what we just said, that a drastic change really takes root, really becomes endurable, only when it goes hand in hand with a rebirth, see? With an illusion, with a faith in a new life, see? Now, this is just what the Negro has to do for himself. This is the Negro community, see? Has to perform something that will win the admiration of the whole world, see, so that every Negro can be proud of his Negro community, of its leaders, and of its achievements.
You've spoken of pride as a substitute for self-esteem. Would you suggest a substitute in this case?
Yeah. You see, this is the plight of the Negro. It's a terrible plight, especially, I can see it, Mr. Day. The Negro individual in a white environment, probably any white environment, not only in America, is always a Negro first, and only secondly, an individual, see? No matter how outstanding his achievements, see? He cannot savor the unbought grace of life, see? Without an identification with a proud Negro community, see? This is what Paul Robeson didn't know. This is what most of the Negro intellectuals didn't know. This is what the Negro middle class didn't know, see? That they have to turn all their attention, you know, on the Negro community. They have to change the life of that community. They have to create a new life. Look, Mr. Day, you pick up the Old Testament and you read about Moses. Moses wanted to perform a simple thing. He wanted to take a tribe of slaves out of Egypt and turn them into free men. Simple. All you have to do, take them out of Egypt and tell them, you're free. But Moses, being a genuine leader, knew that this apparently simple thing is altogether not simple, see. And the whole fabric, the whole mythological and the theological fabric of the Old Testament shows what of the five books of Moses, shows what Moses tried to do in order to enable those slaves to become genuinely free men. He had to invent a Jehovah, a one and only God, who had a one and only people. He had to invent the idea of a promised land, see. And after all this, he invented all this, he still doubted whether a tribe of slaves could really become free men. He decided that he had to wait for a new generation, so he took that tribe of slaves took him into the desert and waited 40 years for the old generation to die, and only the new generation, desert-born and desert-bred, was fit to go in the promised land, into the promised land, and become a free people. So you can see why I gave this book the title, The Ordeal of Change.
Yes.
To me, change is the most explosive process. And the funny part of it is that only lately I realized that there is one change, one drastic change that's going on in all communities, no matter what stage of civilization they are. And this is the change from childhood to manhood. And we know it's an explosive process. Everybody knows that this transition from childhood to manhood is terribly explosive, and that it has that awful byproduct of juvenile delinquency. To me, nationalism, socialism is the juvenile delinquency of nations going to the travail of change, to the ordeal of change. See?
What initiates the desire for change in Asia, for example, Mr. Hoffer? Is it communist agitation? Is it a casting off of colonial oppression? Or a casting off of corrupt governments?
Well, you see, the backward countries, the war has done something to all the backward countries. I mean, you go down to, I mean, you look at India, you look at Indonesia, you look at all these countries in Africa. The war has done something. The war has been a turning point. I mean, up to the Second World War, there were revolutions, of course. But the colonial powers were not convinced, you know, that the end has come. Something has happened. See, nobody knows how that spirit came abroad. It's a time of change. It's a time of an awakening, see. Yeah. Something mysterious almost happened. Imagine what it took for England, you know, to suddenly lose faith, you know, in its own ability to rule a world there. See? Who knows what's going on inside a nation? After all, England came out as a conqueror. And yet, it has happened. See? The empire falling apart. The colonial countries, they're pulling each its way. Something. Of course, the example of Russia played a role too. See, our competition with Russia, our vying for for souls with her there, see, made also possible for the backward countries to come into their own. But the process is just beginning. See. In every case, it's just beginning.
What about the Soviet satellite countries? One of your chapters is entitled Popular Upheavals in Communist Countries. And here is an area where I suppose Americans have hoped for change of some sort.
You know, when I wrote The True Believer, I actually wrote it in 48, you know, the first draft. Mm-hmm. I predicted that the unrest in the communist countries will come when the communist leadership will relax, when the communist leadership will try to become liberalized, liberal, see? In other words, when the moment the people there will get a taste of the good life, then one should expect an explosion there, see?
You mean when one would not expect the explosion when the...
When Stalin was in power there, when the people were really had their nose in mud, see? Mm-hmm. In other words...
When their situation is the worst, is not the time when they're
more... No, that's just it, see? That it's hope. It's the immediate hope. The feeling that you almost have it within your grasp. Then... It is when people become rebellious. Then it is when they become militant. And you could almost predict. You know, the revolts in Eastern Germany, in Hungary and Poland always came to us as a surprise. Nobody really expected that anything is going to happen in communist regimes. We always believed that the communists had an enormous power, you know, to crush souls and to subdue people there. And yet, the theory was there. See, you could see. Many years before the death of Stalin, you could predict almost in what countries the revolution might break out. Some sort of revolution might break out. Of course, you can't predict the future. But
you did select Eastern Germany as one of the places where revolution was most likely. And why was this so?
Because you see, any time that I consider the question of revolution, I am always aware, you know, that the individual by himself, see, cannot accomplish much, no matter what his powers are. The individual by himself, see, is a transitory thing. He has just a short life. And when he's dead, he's finished. In order for the individual to get up on his hind legs and fight, he needs to identify himself with something outside himself, something eternal, and something momentous, something impressive. See, and it seemed to me that in Eastern Germany, this identification with something outside themselves is the most tangible.
This is Western Germany, of course.
Western Germany and more or less Berlin. Berlin was open. You could actually cross into Berlin and see what you identify yourselves with, and I suggested also, you know, that those nations with proud, defiant ancestors are the most likely to revolt there. Mm-hmm. See, you know, the proud Poles, the proud Hungarians, the Czechs, not much. The Czechs have a synthetic past there, see. The Czechs are too cautious there, see. The Romanians, not so much either. So, in other words, you had enough theory on hand at that time, you know, to expect some sort of an explosion once Khrushchev started, once the successors of Stalin started to relax their hold on the people.
What can these people identify with today other than Western Germany or Western Berlin?
Well, of course, the
America?
No, we are too far. We are too strange. We haven't gotten the words. But it's a united Europe. You remember, I wrote that article there so many years ago, see, before even they started to think about it. But I could visualize what a tremendous object of identification a united Europe would be for the captive populations in Poland, in Hungary, in Czechoslovakia, in every satellite, in every country just outside the natural borders of Soviet Russia. Really, it's breathtaking when you consider what a united Europe would be. You can compare nothing with it. See, not even America, because after all, we are just a reason for European pride. America was created by the undesirables cast out by Europe. See, and if the undesirable element did that much there, then Europe itself could do an awful lot.
Mr. Hoffer, I want to continue this conversation with you in our next meeting and ask you something about the role of the intellectuals in this process of change, because I know from what you've written you have a great many thoughts on the role of the intellectuals, and then we'll pursue that to the role of the masses and the weak.
Thank you very much.
That was the first in a series of six conversations between Eric Hoffer and James Day, General Manager of KQED San Francisco. This is NET, National Educational Television.